Thank you for the primes, boys. Thank you for the primes, boys. I appreciate it. I was still wrong either way. It doesn't change anything. If you guys haven't already, you have to click on the subscribe button. Scroll down to see if it says subscribe free in the checkbox. Hello. You look nice. How's it going? You're leaving now? Oh, gosh. Your thing? I'm not standing up. Not my cock and ball.
Wow, you really use that camera in the weirdest way possible. I can't
get it. Nailed it. Bing, bing, bing. Bing, bing, bing. What time you come back?
I don't know.
All right. I'll just be here fighting the good fight. Super Auto Pets is the good fight. Worthwhile adventure. Have fun. Say hello to everyone. No. I haven't told them what to you're going to.
Everybody's going to dinner, but Ludwig's staying home to hang out with you guys.
Everyone's going to dinner, and I'm bailing to hang out with you guys. I'm hanging out with you guys today. Woohoo! Ludwig and Chad hangout session. Let's go. Doesn't make me a loser. That's not true.
I don't really know why, besides hanging out with you guys. There's literally no other reason. So,
that and I need to farm YouTube videos because I have zero uploads ready for the Thanksgiving week.
We're going to go cooking stream at my house.
It's not. We have a cooking stream that we're going to do.
A my house.
I'm cooking a turkey as well. I'll be cooking a turkey as well. That's in addition. In addition, I will be cooking a turkey.
What else are you gonna cook?
That's it.
Well, you said in addition.
In addition to being there, I will also be cooking a turkey. Okay. Turkey cooking stream. Let's go. We're not doing Super Auto Pets right now, Chad. I still need to farm YouTube videos. We can't just jump to Super Auto Pets. My playlist is now public. You guys can find it. It's on my channel, or you can do exclamation point music playlist. Thank you for the sub, Neff said. Thank you, Yuki is God. Hazy Golden Antlers. I have to pee real quick. His name's Raphael. Yeah, sure. Merry Christmas, Raphael. Oh, whoa. Ludwig interacting with viewers? What's going on? Sheesh. You watch a new Summoning Salt video? We did watch it. And if you guys haven't seen the new Ludwig, not the new, it's the same channel, but the Ludwig Vaz channel has had a bit of a reskin. It's changed a bit now to be more similar to maybe like Small Ants Vaz channel, but a little more consistent than that. So instead of just being like an 8-hour chunk and then trying to be like, this is what happened in it, it's cut up into sections. So like just me reacting to the Summoning Salt video and then Jon Bois videos is on the Ludwig's Vaz channel, as well as like Super Auto Pets gameplay, the tournament, Bro vs. Bro is there as a full VOD. So if you ever want to watch a VOD of the stream, you can do so on YouTube and they'll just be available here. I would use this channel if it actually uploaded immediately. I mean, yeah, sure. That makes sense. You know that's just impossible. Because, like, they have to download it and upload it. So that's just the problem. Battlefield payouts. Net 30, my king. I think I set pretty decent expectations of the timeline you can expect. We're working on it. Hopefully it comes before then.
What is going on, guys? My name is John, and welcome back to yet another video. With the release of Pokemon Brilliant Diamond and Shining Pearl this month, I figured I'd start off the new games right by testing myself with the Catch 'Em All Challenge, and then comparing it to the original Diamond and Pearl games and seeing just how much easier or harder it is to complete. Today we're going to find out how easy you can catch every Pokemon in Brilliant Diamond and Shining Pearl. Now, if you haven't seen one of my videos before, I've included a playlist in the top right that contains all the previous videos if you're interested. However, the rules are pretty simple. The goal at the end of the challenge is to collect a complete living dex of every Sinnoh Pokemon in the remakes.
I'm not watching this whole video. There's no spoilers. I'm just... Someone said he calls you out in this video, and I don't know where.
Within a span of 24 in-game hours. I'll be playing both copies of the game to make it a little bit more difficult, and I've basically split the catches right down the middle, so realistically, both games have the same amount of work. Obviously, no glitches will be used in this, but the games literally just came out, so I'm sure it would take more time to find one of those than it would be to do the actual challenge. Before we get into the video, be sure to leave a like and subscribe for more content like this. Roughly only 40% of the people that watch my videos are actually subscribed, and you can always change your mind down the road. Also, before you say it, I know that I haven't uploaded this channel like at all this year, but just know that I'm working on an enormous video that should be out by the end of this year, but I appreciate you all for being so patient with the content. With all that out of the way, let's just jump right into it. Now, if you watch me—
Okay, never mind. Hey, I gave it a minute 36:37. How do you know that? The video... I fucking hate you guys. It's not funny, guys. It's not funny, bro. It's not. You guys think you're so clever. You guys think you're so clever, dude. You want to watch a Jon Bois video, maybe? Little Jon Bois action.
In the NFL, a 1-0 score is impossible, right? You can't just score 1 point by itself. It's not math.
Every NFL score ever. I only know about NFL scores and the likelihood because I don't know if you guys ever had this. Sometimes I would hang out with like friends when I was younger, and you might not have ever had that, but sometimes when there's like a big game like the Super Bowl, you would bet on the score. I forget what you call it. You basically get like a tile of what the score could be, and you bet on that, and then you get money. I don't know what they call those, but I used to play that a bit. Scorigami? Is that what it's called?
In the NFL, a 1-0 score is impossible, right? You can't just score 1 point by itself. It's not mathematically achievable. 1-1 is an impossible score, so are 2-1, 3-1, 4-1, 5-1, and 7-1. 6-1 is possible. Thanks to an obscure loophole in the NFL rulebook, a final score of 6-1 can technically happen. It would require a turn of events so staggeringly, stupidly unlikely that I'm almost positive it will never happen under current NFL rules, but because it's technically possible, a score of 6-1 is the crown jewel of scorigami, a word that I made up. It's the art of building final scores that have never happened before in NFL history. Even after a century of play and more than 15,000 games, this beautiful craft is still alive today.
How do you get 6-1? How do you score one? Okay, my understanding of football is very simple. American football, you can score 7-6. Shit, no, I'm already forgetting. If you score a touchdown, you get 6 points, and then you have the option to get an extra point by kicking the football through the uprights. Or you can go for two where you score another touchdown with a smaller field. So you either get 7 points or 8 points, or six if you fuck it up. And then a field goal gets you 3 points, and then a safety, which is when you are on offense but you get sacked in your own end zone, gets 2 points. And those are, I think, the only ways I know how to get points in football.
This is the scorigami board. Over the course of the next few minutes, we'll fill it with every single NFL score that has ever happened. But first, let's take a minute and survey the boundaries. The number of points scored by the winning team determines the column. The number of points scored by the losing team determines the row. So, for example, let's say a game ends with a score of 21-17. So that's here. 28-0, that's here. A 14-14 tie, that would be here. Now the reason half the board is blacked out is that naturally the loser can't have more points than the winner. For example, you can win a game 17-14, you cannot win a game 14-17. Up here it gets a little bit messy, because remember, you can't have a 1-1 tie, that's blacked out. You can't win 2-1, 3-1, 4-1, 5-1, or 7-1, 6-1. Again, it really is possible, and I promise we will get to that.
I think I know how!
Chart stops at 73 because that's the highest number of points an NFL team has ever scored. Of course, there could be a 90-12 game or a 156-112 game. I mean, longtime viewers will remember the 222-0 college football game. And even if we're talking about a football game that ends like 4,000 to 3,000, it's beyond the limits of physics and human anatomy, yeah, but it's not against the rule book, so it's technically in play. So I don't know about you, but the ideal football game I want to watch is a close game with a decent amount of scoring, like 27-21 or 31-28, you know, somewhere around.
Speaking of foosball, how are the Buccaneers doing? They're playing right now. They're winning against the Giants. Nice.
Around there. Well, we started the year 1922, the first year the NFL was called the NFL.
We watched a 222 video.
Like... From a fan's perspective, this is a disaster. Look at that top row that's covered in green. That means we've got a lot of shutout wins. Look at up there in the upper left-hand corner. That means we have a bunch of low-scoring games. 3-0 games, nothing-nothing games. If I were in charge of the NFL back then, I would have immediately canceled it. Look, the 0-0 score is lit up. Now, what that little light doesn't tell you is that there were 5-0-0 games that season. Not just one. 51 games were shutouts. More than two-thirds of all games in 1922 were shutouts.
That's,
I mean,
so
boring. It's not
boring.
Asking a lot to win a game in which A, both teams score double digits, and B, one team actually wins the game. Out of all 74 games, there are two that fit that description. Two. You know what? I have a lot of quit in me, and they clearly didn't, because they came back the next year, and it was still terrible.
The only game where I feel like it's acceptable to have a 0-0 game and it still be entertaining is, like, soccer.
Look, everybody, there's even a 2-0 game. A safety was the only score of the game.
Or hockey.
It wasn't just any safety. It was a ground rule safety. There was a fence in the end zone, and for some reason they decided that if the ball hit the fence, it would be a safety instead of a touchdown. And that's how we have the first 2-0 game in the history of the NFL.
Wait.
Rule safety. There was a fence in the end zone, and for some reason they decided that if the ball hit the fence, it would be a safety instead of a touchdown. And that's how we have the first 2-0 game in the history of the NFL.
That's so
and
random.
And we also have the only time a team ever scored exactly 4 points in a game. They did it naturally with two safeties. So what about this block over here? Will we ever see a 4-4 game with both teams scoring two safeties and tying?
No shot.
Well, all right, let's just imagine the NFL stays exactly like it has in the 21st century. All right, stick with me here because the numbers are about to get really big, really fast.
Okay.
On average, a team scores a safety every 32 games, so the odds of scoring two in a game are about 1 in 1,000. The score has to stay at 4 points, so the offense has to be shut out. The odds of that are about 1 in 70. So for a team to finish with exactly 4 points is about 1 in 74,000. Now, for this to happen to both teams in the same game, the odds of that would be 1 in about 5.5 billion.
Oh, fight the urge to make the joke. Fight the urge to make the joke.
Of course, we're still not done because these odds only get us to the end of regulation. This overtime has to be scoreless, right? So the odds of a completely scoreless overtime are about 1 in 87, which means the probability of 4-4...
Fucking dream luck, dude!
Final score is about 1 in 471 billion games. There are 267 games in a season, so if NFL rules and behaviors never change,
I'm
we could expect to see one 4-4 game every 1.7 billion years. Hey, you know what? That's pretty good news, because we should have about 4 billion years before the surface of the Earth gets melted off by the heat of the sun, so there's plenty of time. That was sad. Let's keep it sad. In 1932, neither the Chicago Bears nor their opponent scored on offense until their fifth game. Through the first 16 quarters of the season, the Bears were outscored 2-0. Here's an article recapping their third straight 0-0 game. Thousands of people knew the Bears opened their season with two scoreless ties, and they went, oh yeah, that sounds fun, and they went and bought a ticket and sat in the rain for hours.
3,000 people showed up.
And watched another scoreless tie, and then they went home. Who are these people? I don't understand these.
Do you think I could get 3,000 people to show up for an event? 3,000 is so many. That is so many people. To, like, appear in person? Unless it was, like, a really sick event. Yeah, I have 18K now, but all they have to do is click internet button. You have to, like, show up somewhere in the world.
These people. Okay, so this is my completely arbitrary idea of a quote-unquote good game. I like offense, so I like to watch a game in which both teams score at least 21 points. That's not a tall order, right? I mean, there were 75 games like that in 2015.
I wouldn't make a Ludwig convention. It's too vain. I feel like people who make a convention about themselves are a little psychopathic.
Peaks and valleys, but throughout most of NFL history, 20 or 30%.
But I think like an event where people can show up and hang out is still a good thing. Like, that's a good thing. I think just the name is the problem. Like, having an event where you hang out with people who like watching you is fine. Calling it Ludwig Con is where it's weird.
...percent of good games have fit into this category. Across the NFL's first 15 years of existence, there were two games in which both teams scored 21 points. Two. But hey, if one-sided clobberings are your kind of deal, the early NFL just might be for you. The most well-known scorigami of all time may have been the 1940 NFL Championship, the precursor to the Super Bowl, in which the Bears beat Washington 73-0. Since then, there have been some 40-point shutout wins and some 50-burger shutout wins, but no team in the last 75 years has come even close to 73-0. Across the history...
Dude, that's so embarrassing. How do you get to the playoffs and then lose 73-0?
Well, scorigami, I see three major spikes. The first came in 1946, when the rival All-America Football Conference was founded. There were 24 scorigami that year, largely because there were twice as many games. After four seasons of the NFL and AAFC completely hating each other and losing money, the NFL absorbed the AAFC and took on a few of its teams, and that is why the AAFC teams are counted here. Now, by this point, we can see a pattern start to emerge. Of course, the four row and column are almost completely empty. Same story with 5 and 11. 15 and 18 are also pretty empty.
73 is the max score that he put for scorigami because no team has scored higher than that. That's the only reason. He talked about it extensively. Like, you could have it be higher. There's no rules against it, but that's just the highest that's ever happened, so that's why it's here.
Now, this sort of demonstrates why scorigami is unique to football.
It's like, sure, it's possible, but why would you put it there and just have blank things? You know what I mean? Just because it's possible doesn't mean it'll happen. Like, it's possible that another team ties the record and loses four straight Super Bowls like the Buffalo Bills did in the 20th century, but it's unlikely.
The way scoring is structured in other sports, scoring 1 point at a time is pretty common. In baseball, you most commonly score one run at a time. In basketball, there are 1 point free throw shots all the time. In hockey and soccer, you can only score by one, so mathematically, a score can only be interesting in terms of magnitude. It really is funny when, say, the Rangers beat the Orioles 30-3, but magnitude is basically the only way it can be funny. The NFL's scoring arithmetic is far more awkward. Virtually all NFL scores are built with these five blocks. The 7-point touchdown and extra point, the 3-point field goal, the 6-point touchdown with no conversion, the 8-point touchdown and 2-point conversion, and the 2-point safety.
Okay.
There are no one blocks here. This is limiting, and the distribution of these scores make them even more limiting. Last season in the NFL, there were more than 1,000 touchdowns, and there were a ton of field goals, too. They were about 106 point touchdowns, thanks to a missed field goal or a missed 2-point conversion, but for scorigami purposes, this isn't really that valuable because a 6-pointer is really just two field goals.
True.
The 8-point touchdown is valuable for scorigami because 8 is a weird number, but there were only 45 to go around all season. Finally, there's everyone's favorite, the safety, of which there were only 16. The distribution here is wildly out of balance, and it's a big reason
like
why scorigami is so special. For example, that's why 8 is so hard to get to. You can build 8 points in 4 different ways, but all of them range from rare to astronomically rare and near impossible. And that is why we only see the number 8 in the box score once or twice a year. But if you really want to get nimble like the other sports, you have to practice in the dark arts of scorigami. These three maneuvers are permitted by NFL rules, but a couple of them have never been used. Okay, you know what? Parental discretion is advised for this bit. Actually, grand parental. Discretion is advised for this bit. If you are under the age of 60, leave the room. First, there is the forfeit. If, for some reason, one team refuses to play, the other team officially wins 2-0. Why 2-0? I don't know. Of course, this can't be used as a building block. It's a prefab final score. Also, there are already a few 2-0 games on the book, so you can't make scorigami out of it. Still, it's there.
What a stupid
Second,
rule.
There's the defensive 2-point conversion. If there's a turnover on a 2-point conversion attempt, and the defense runs it back to the other end zone, they get 2 points. This is clunky, though, because it comes tethered to the 6-point touchdown the other team had to score in order to force this play in the first place. And third, There was the defensive one-point safety. Now, some of you are thinking, wait, I saw this in college football one time, didn't I? I know what you're talking about. You're talking about this, right?
We have an unusual ruling. The ball was blocked, pulled current back into the end zone, and declared dead by the defense. That play results in a one-point safety.
And yes, that was crazy, but ultimately that just results in a seventh point, which is nothing special in the world of scoregami. This is not that. I'm talking about something far, far stupider than that. And I promise we will get to it. All right, kids, we're back.
Oh, come on!
In 1960, we see another huge increase in scoregami. The most obvious reason for this is the founding of the AFL, which featured eight new teams that would eventually join the NFL.
Quick history lesson of the NFL. It was the American Football League and the National Football League, and there were two totally separate leagues. You know, you can think like NASCAR and F1. I mean, a little more similar than that. And then they merged, and then that's where the Super Bowl spawned in 1970 after the merger. Anyway.
Second sneakier reason is that unlike the NFL, the AFL allowed for the two-point conversion. Over the next decade, AFL teams would score 80 two-pointers. Even one of those blips is enough to tip a highly conventional score into scoregami. And it works the other way, too. In 1961, the Oilers and Bills were well on their way to a super conventional 28-17 game. There have been 62 NFL games with that score, but after Buffalo scored to cut the Houston lead to 21-16, they decided to go for the two-pointer to get within a field goal. Mm. They failed. They were stuck at 16, and that's scoregami. Similar story here in 1964. The Raiders and Patriots have scored conventionally, and the Pats lead late, 35-34. Oakland scores a touchdown, but because they want to go up a clean 7 points, they go for two, and they fail. Then Boston scores a touchdown, and they want to go up a clean three in the event of a field goal, so they go for two. It's good. The Raiders do kick that field goal, and the game ends in a 43-43 tie. To this day, it's the highest scoring tie in NFL history.
That's dope.
2 years later, in 66, New York and Washington played the highest scoring NFL game of all time, 72-41. Pete Gogolak kicked for New York, his brother Charlie kicked for Washington. Together, they kicked 14 extra points that day, and thanks to those points, this game still stands today as the greatest outlier in the history of NFL scoring. It's also thanks to really, really, really bad tackling. Oof. And finally, after nearly...
Did you guys see that? Was I blocking that? It didn't look like a tackle. It looks like how people put their hand on cheeks in movie kisses.
Bad tackling.
Look at that. You see that? That's not a tackle, dude. That's called you might love your homie a little.
Oof. And finally, after nearly 50 years of existence, the NFL's concrete was beginning to set. The AFL and the NFL had merged, the Super Bowl became a fixture, and the two-point conversion was done away with entirely. The league's popularity grew, and the art of scoregami began to die.
They got rid of it?
In 1992, there was only one scoregami, the lowest number the NFL had ever seen. It sure didn't help things that the extra point had become essentially a formality. As the rules evolved, the kicking got better, and by the 50s, extra points were nearly automatic. In 1974, the goal was moved back, and PATs were slightly less automatic for a few years, and then they rebounded, and they became more automatic than ever. In 2015, the extra points were moved back to the 15-yard line, and even that only dipped the accuracy 4 or 5%. And in 2016, it's rebounding again. But in 1994, the NFL finally brought themselves to innovate. The NFL reintroduced the two-point conversion, and in doing so, they saved the art of scoregami. This was the third great scoregami bump. In the years that followed, NFL teams created scoregami not only by making two-point conversions, but by missing them. Week one of the 2002 season, we saw one of the strangest endings to a game in NFL history.
It's a good rule.
The Chiefs
it is
and
interesting
the Browns
that, like,
are in a dogfight.
No matter how far back they put the field goal, the accuracy just goes up. So, like, if they theoretically just threw that field goal back, like, 30, 40 yards, then the kickers would just become phenomenal. They would become so good.
Cleveland scores a touchdown to take a 36-31 lead. They go for two and they miss, instantly putting this game on scoregami red alert. At this point in history, there are plenty of scores involving a 36 that have never happened. A few minutes later, Priest Holmes rushes for his third touchdown of the fourth quarter, and the Chiefs miss their own two-point conversion. It's 37-36. If this holds, it will be scoregami. It doesn't hold. The Browns drive downfield and kick a field goal with 29 seconds remaining. It's 39-37. If this holds, this will be scoregami. This isn't going to hold either, because the dam of football weirdness has bust wide open. After the field goal, the holder, Chris Gardocki, gets flagged for taunting. One story says it was the kicker who actually did the taunting. In any case, a kicker or holder getting called for taunting basically never happens. It backs up the ensuing kickoff, and the Chiefs are aided by slightly better field position. With 2 seconds left, down by two at their own 47, the Chiefs have to go for broke. Halfway to the ground, quarterback Trent Green chucks the ball in desperation to John Tate, a lineman who has never run with the ball in his entire life. All 315 pounds of John Tate rumble all the way to the Cleveland 25 before he's forced out. The clock hits zero and the coaches walk over to shake hands. It's not over. The officials call everyone off the field. Dwayne Rudd, who thought he sacked Trent Green to end the game, never saw Tate scoop the ball and run with it. He thought the game was over and he threw his helmet in celebration in the middle of the play. That is a taunting penalty. As a rule, the Chiefs get one more untimed down. And thanks to Tate's run and a little penalty yardage tacked on, all Morton Anderson had to do is chip in a 30-yard field goal. 40-39, this is an exceptionally difficult scoregami to achieve. Not only is one of the numbers difficult to build with an NFL score, both...
Hey, you know what, by the way? Phenomenal journalism. What the helmet? Good job, Patrick. Good job.
...of them are. And not only that, it required both teams to score at least 39 points, which in and of itself is very rare, once every 391 games. Appropriately, one of the most bizarre finishes of all time resulted in a score that might never happen again.
Scoregami!
Scoregami is an exhaustible resource, but it's not exhausted just yet. This decade, there have been 46 acts of scoregami so far, including one act of what I call low scoregami. In other words, scoregami in which both teams score 15 points or fewer. Now, these are really rare because the permutations required to make them are often very specific and very claustrophobic. Of course, teams never actually try to make scoregami because they don't know what it is because it's a word I made up, but this low scoregami of 13-8 is about as close as it gets to intentional.
I bet nowadays it happens. I bet nowadays Bill Belichick, especially when he had Tom Brady at the helm, was like, I mean, we'll go fucking stupid. We'll just make some shit. I'll make some plays up.
10 seconds left, the 49ers led 13-6, a score that had happened literally 50 times, but
Pete Carroll
Niners
does.
Coach Jim Harbaugh doesn't want to punt it away, so he instructs his punter, Andy Lee, to kill as much time as he can and take the safety if he has to. He runs into the end zone to complete the scoregami. Fun! Harbaugh was a noted scoregami artist during his time in the NFL. Bill Belichick, he also belongs in this category.
Told you.
But the wizard of modern scoregami, without question, is Seahawks coach Pete Carroll. Not only has he completed a league-leading 7 scoregami since 2010, he has won all 7 of them. Carroll's most famous scoregami was a decade in the making. In 2002, the Seahawks got a new stadium. It rains a lot during football season in Seattle. Their solution was to build cantilever roofs above the stands to keep the fans dry. It did that, but it also reflected crowd noise back toward the field. The fans were loud, the stadium made them louder, the fans celebrated their loud reputation by being even louder, and the stadium made their even louder noise even louder, and so on. This reputation grew as the team found success. They played in their first Super Bowl after the 2005 season, and 5 years later, toward the end of a shocking playoff win, the fans were so loud that they famously registered a miniature earthquake.
Oh, look at this run! What a run! Marshawn Lynch! Still on his feet! He's dancing his way for the touchdown!
This made Seahawks fans world famously loud, and they seemed determined to uphold that reputation. Years later, the Seahawks went to the Super Bowl across the country, and the fans came with them. On the first play from scrimmage, the noise was deafening. Peyton Manning turns to adjust the play. His center doesn't hear him.
It's snapped over the head!
It was the first game since at least 1994, and maybe the only NFL game ever.
Dude, I remember this.
On the first play from scrimmage, it established both Seattle.
That doesn't sound loud. Turn your headphones up, man.
Seattle's dominance and Denver's awkward numerical footing, and both made possible a 43-8 Super Bowl scoregami. So as of the date is November 30th. As of November 30th, there have been 5 scoregami this year. So here's where we are. Opportunities are scarce. There are some vacancies in the 32-point column that look kind of like a Tetris block with a rapid-fire laser cannon. There are weird, lonely, unscratchable itches like 25-18, 20-11, 14-8. There are vast, uncharted territories in the scoring Arctic, reachable only if one
Teach
or
me
both
about
teams
six to
score
one.
Tons of points. But even that is less remote than the four-point canyon. Aside from that single 10-4 game from 1923, no team has ever finished with 4 points. Under the current rules, this canyon seems forever out of reach. But hey, I mean, rules have changed before, and they're going to change again. If the NFL, for example, were ever to borrow the one-point rouge from the CFL, the four-pointer would instantly become far more reachable. Now, before we go, I know I told you I would tell you about the 6-1 score. Okay, so it's a scoreless game. Mm-hmm. Team A scores a touchdown. Let's say they go for two, and they suffer a safety. On a conversion attempt, you only get 1 point for a safety, not two. So that is 6-1. But think about what would have to happen here. The offense would have to suffer a safety in their own end zone 98 yards in the wrong direction. That might go something like this. Team A turns the ball over to Team B. Team B runs it almost all the way back, but they fumble right before they get to the end zone. Team A recovers in the end zone, falls on the ball, and is tackled. This can be drawn. I don't think it can be done.
I've done that in Madden. I've done that in Madden like 100 times. I feel like half my Madden gameplay is running back trying to run around the offensive or the defensive line.
Until the day that's done, there will always be one hole in this board, and Scorigami will live forever. Looking for more great videos on YouTube? I'm gonna level with you. I think this is the only good YouTube video. And
wait, Scorigami happened tonight? No. Okay, I got you baited. Scorigami tracking the chances that NFL games finish with a score that's never happened, built by DP Mattingly, based on Jon Bois' idea. There's a 2% chance that it ends. Most likely Scorigami is 40-31. Wait, there was one this week? Where? The Bills and the Colts? I wish you would only post the Scorigamis. You know? Forty-one to 15. That's Scorigami. It's the 1,070th unique score in NFL history. Sheesh. I guess 15 is a weird number, huh? 15's kind of like, what are you doing getting 15? And then you score 40 on that 15er? That's pretty good. This is the video Summoning Salt recommended.
This is probably going to sound stupid, but what if Barry Bonds had played without a bat?
It is stupid. It is stupid. It is a stupid question. Yeah, you know, that is dumb. I'll watch it. Yeah, this is good clickbait. I have been baited to watch this video successfully. I had not thought about this, but I will do it.
It sounded as stupid as I thought it would. I'm serious though, what if Barry Bonds went up to the batter's box empty-handed every time and just stood there until he was walked, struck out, or hit by a pitch? I wanted to know, so I simulated every plate appearance of his 2004 season as though he didn't have a bat, and it turns out that without a baseball bat, Barry Bonds would still be really, really good.
What? How? Because he steals bases? Because he punches the balls?
Hey, could someone get the lights? Thank you. Barry Bonds was one of the best baseball players who has ever lived. What was his secret? Nobody knows. If you think you know, please go to the comments below and get into a huge fight.
Steroids? He did steroids, right? Like, factually did steroids, not like looking at a Hawkeye on Instagram and saying you did steroids so that you feel better about yourself because you haven't gone to the gym in years. like actually did it.
Before we get to our experiment, let's examine how good he was with a bat. What you're looking at is the entire history of Major League hitting. There are more than 17,000 dots on this timeline, and they represent the OPS of every full season a hitter ever had. OPS is a great stat. If your OPS is high, it means you get on base a lot, you hit for extra bases a lot, and you probably hit a lot of home runs. If your OPS is 1,000, you might win the MVP award, but if your OPS is 1,250, you might be the greatest hitter ever to walk the earth. As you can see, no hitter ever made it that high for the first 50 years or so of Major League Baseball, and then Babe Ruth came along and did it six times in an eight-year span.
I need to understand OPS more before I continue this video. I don't want to pretend that I understand what this means, and I'm sure chat might feel the same. The actual definition, or a full word for it, is on-base plus slugging. OPS adds on the base percentage and slugging percentage to get you a number that combines the two. Okay, on base percentage, very easy. The amount of times that you hit the ball and you get to a base. That makes a lot of sense to me. Nobody's confused. Slugging percentage is confusing. It represents the total number of bases a player records at bat. Okay, never mind. Oh, no, I don't get it. This is just the amount of times that you will be at the plate and then you will either be walked because they do four balls, they hit you so you get to walk to the base, or you hit the ball and you get to go to the base. And that's the amount of times that you do that. That's what OPS is, right? Then my question is, what is 1250? Like, what does that constitute? Because that seems high. That seems like more than... So, oh, I get it. So, if you are at bat and you get on a base, first base... This is like, okay, one means you are guaranteed to get, like, first base every time. Like, if you divide the math. On average, you get to first base every time. And 1.25 is like, you're getting to second sometimes. Is this right? You get 1.25 bases on average. So, theoretically, you could get, like, a high score of, like, four if you just get a home run every time. That's just slugging percentage. OPS also adds on base percentage to that. I see.
1,000, you might win the MVP award, but if your OPS is 1250, you might be the greatest hitter ever to walk the earth. As you can see, no hitter ever made it that high for the first 50 years or so of Major League Baseball, and then Babe Ruth came along and did it six times in an eight-year span. Only man ever to get to 1250 until 1941 when the great Ted Williams hit 1287.
Good job, Ted.
Then he went off to war, came back, and managed to do it again. And
that's crazy.
Decades after that, despite the best efforts of Hank Aaron,
16 years
Mantle,
later? What?
Mays, William Covey, nobody even came close. Even in the power mad 1990s, nobody could quite get there. And
Mark
then,
McGuire,
for the first time in nearly half a century, four players broke the 1250 barrier. Their names were Barry Bonds, Barry Bonds, Barry Bonds, and Barry Bonds.
Just another hit, Barry Bonds.
In four consecutive years, Bonds put together the fourth best, second best, eighth best, and best season in the history of baseball. This history was written by thousands of players over the course of 130 years, and one man laid waste to all of it as though it was nothing. You might think this is mostly a function of the era he played in. Okay, well, here's Barry Bonds' OPS in 2004, and there's the second best that year by Todd Helton, and there's Craig Counsell's, the worst. The difference between Bonds and...
Get fucking owned, Craig. You dipshit.
Number two is
so embarrassing.
Almost as great as the difference between...
Spot the Ludwig viewer. Is it Craig, Todd, or Barry?
Number two and number 161.
It's Craig.
It's like he almost lapped him. Barry Bonds broke baseball. Look at this. In 2001, he hit a major league record 73 home runs, but in 2004, his OPS was better despite hitting far fewer home runs. Turns out there's only one thing more powerful than home run ability. Fear. The rest of baseball was scared of him. In 2004, opposing pitchers walked Bonds 232 times, an all-time record that is probably unbreakable. 120 of those times, the pitcher did the work for him by walking him intentionally. This is another unbreakable record, because even if you look at the all-time top 10 intentional walkers, his total doubles or triples the rest of the field, including guys like Barry Bonds. The ultimate sign of fear and respect is to walk a man with the bases loaded, as Greg Olson did to Barry Bonds in 1998. Now, second to that would be walking a guy with the bases empty. The worst that's going to happen is a solo home run. Are you really that scared? It happens, but it's rare. Since 1930, it's happened 165 times in all of Major League Baseball, so about twice a year. Here's a very brief history of the bases empty intentional walk. For a long time, it almost never happened, and then it started happening way more. Those chunks in orange are all the bases empty intentional walks issued to Barry Bonds.
So 2004, he's the only guy who got walked?
Look at 2004. They issued 19 intentional bases empty walks in Major League Baseball, and they were all to Barry Bonds. This isn't just a bunch of bars and numbers you're looking
at. With the bases empty.
This is fear. Fear was his bat. He didn't need a bat. Let's take his bat away. Okay, so this is the nature of our experiment. Barry Bonds travels through a wormhole back to 2004 and relives each one of his 617 plate appearances without a baseball bat. He just stands in the batter's box and whatever happens, happens. Maybe he gets struck out, maybe he gets hit by a pitch, maybe he draws a walk. So he just gets struck out every time, right? Well, here's the kicker. The pitchers don't know he doesn't have a bat. They throw him the exact same pitches they otherwise would have. So let's see how often Bonds gets on base. Let's find exactly how far one man can get through nothing but reputation and fear. For this experiment, we need to get all the data we can get our hands on. I was originally hoping to use PitchFX, a computerized pitch tracking system, but unfortunately it wasn't introduced until 2006, just a little bit too late. Thank God for RetroSheet, which is probably the most comprehensive historical archive of any sport that exists anywhere. Decades of exhaustive research have produced pitch-by-pitch data of a countless number of games, including every game Barry Bonds played in 2004. RetroSheet tells us every single pitch, every ball, every called strike, every swinging strike, everything. This is a goldmine. Let's start with the plate appearances we don't have to experiment with at all. Barry Bonds made 617 plate appearances, and in 191 of them, he never swung his bat. About those 191, in two of them he struck out looking, five of them ended when he got hit by the pitch, 67 were walks, and 117 more were intentional walks. So in real life, when Barry Bonds didn't swing the bat, his on-base percentage was 990. Now, to suggest this rate would stretch across an entire season wouldn't be very honest, because there was a reason Barry Bonds, who had tremendous plate discipline, didn't swing at these. They were bad pitches to hit. Pitchers were scared of him all season, but not that scared. No, we need to take the long road with this one. Let's see what you got, Barry.
Just a stock image of him standing.
I've got all 617 plate appearances loaded up and divided into three categories. Walks are hit by pitches, strikeouts, and plate appearances that ended with a ball hit into play. First, let's knock out the easy ones, the walks or the hit by pitches.
Can I have a hot take? I think steroids make sports better. I feel like it would also be healthier if they were openly allowed to do steroids in a more controlled way where the doctors could at least administer it rather than having to figure it out themselves and do it like a weird, shady way in a back alley with a fucking needle they found from a dude. I said it was hot. It would also, you know, I'm also not very knowledgeable on the medicinal side effects of steroids. I'm not very knowledgeable on that. I won't lie to you. I'm just imagining you throw doctor into the equation in some more controlled fashion, and it's probably a better outcome than what happens normally. Because it's not always dangerous, right? They're not all terrible. Steroids are often used as like a drug, like a medicine.
This is the pitch-by-pitch notation we found on RetroSheet. You can tell that these are the 9 hit-by-pitches because they all end with the letter H. Below this, we've got a ton of intentional walks. Most of them have 4 I's, each of which stands for an intentional ball, but these are funnier to me. Look at this one, BFBBI. So basically this means that the pitcher threw him an unintentional ball and then Bonds fouled one off and then he took balls 2 and 3. So the count was 3 and 1 and the pitcher was just like, I'm good. So obviously if Bonds didn't have a bat for this plate appearance, he couldn't have possibly turned this into a strikeout. The same should go for all of these, right? Bat or not, the walks would stand as called, right? Well, that's almost always true. Some require further analysis, like this one, CBCBBFB.
Dude, this is like the eye test you do at a doctor.
That means there was a called strike, ball 1, another called strike, ball 2, ball 3, and then, on full count, a foul. Our Barry Bonds can't hit a foul ball because he doesn't have a bat, so what does he do? What do? We simulate it. What do we think that foul ball would have been if Barry didn't swing at it? Well, thanks to data I found on Fangraphs, if he swung at a pitch, there was an 80.9% chance it was somewhere inside the strike zone. That's quite a compliment to him, but it's kind of a drag for us because that means there's only a 19.1% chance this was a ball. So to reflect those odds, we generate a random number between 1 and 1,000. If the number we get is 191 or lower, it's a ball. Any other number is a strike.
Okay, this makes
sense.
Odds
are against us here,
but we
got a shot. Full count. 191 or below, he walks. Oh, crab apples. Well, he struck out on this one. We had to take some other walks off the board, too. Of the 14 walks up for foul ball review, 6 ended up being simulated as strikeouts. So instead of his 232 real-life walks, Bonds now has 226 walks plus 9 hit-by-pitches for an on-base percentage of 381. Is that good? Yeah, it's actually really good. He's already in the 82nd percentile of all the eligible seasons in baseball history. Of course,
I thought it was bad. I thought that was like dog shit. Is this not the same as OPS? It's OBP, not OPS. Fucking hell.
Of course, it's nowhere near the 609 he managed in real life with a baseball bat, but it's still good enough for 27th in baseball that year, right between Ivan Rodriguez and Sean Casey. But of course, we're not done counting yet. I ran each of Bonds' 41 strikeouts through the same simulation just to see if we can get any of them to flip. And just as before, all the pitches in white are real-life pitches that remain unchanged in our simulation, and the orange pitches are the ones that have a 19% chance of being a ball. But for some of these, we needed more. Check out this one. Ball, ball, foul, foul, strike. In real life, that's a strikeout, but our Barry didn't swing at those, and one of them turned out to be a ball. The next pitch ends up being a strike, the count's full, and we ran out of pitches. We have to make another pitch up. Now the good news here is that we don't have to use those odds we were using before because those are restricted to pitches Barry swung at. We get to dig out of the barrel of every pitch thrown his way, period.
How is it possible to have a typo that's edited to be correct in the video? Why not just...
can be any old pitch, and in total
you could just like yellow this out, and then
58.7 of all the pitches he saw were balls. So this time,
oh, because it moves and it's a pain in the ass.
Anything 587 or below is a ball, and anything above is a strike. So in this plate appearance, the better odds didn't really help us, but in total we did manage to flip a few. We can add,
he uses Google Earth for this? Are you serious?
Add 7 more walks to the total, which pushes Barry Bonds on base percentage to 392. Now he's in the 88th percentile, despite not having a bat. Pretty amazing. He now ranks 18th in 2004, right between Gary Sheffield and Vlad Guerrero. So you think we can get him here? Can Barry lead the league in on-base percentage without a bat? We have 335 plate appearances left to find out.
Someone said starting a PlayStation. How is that possible? You're telling me he's 0.001 difference without a bat?
No. No, no, no way. That's you cannot have the best on-base percentage in the history of baseball without a bat. Impossible. I must have done something wrong. I did all the calculations correct mathematically, but maybe my approach was wrong. Maybe that 58.7% chance of the random pitch being a ball, maybe that is unfair for me to use somehow. I don't think I did anything wrong, but I look at the result. I think I'm full of crap. I think I have to be just like some idiot who's full of crap. Please show up in the comments and tell me how I'm full of crap, because I genuinely want to know, because I have to be, right? Because this is impossible. But what if I'm right? What if that was a fair simulation and we found that the best way to get on base for Barry Bonds was to not do anything? What does that say about baseball? Nothing good.
Okay, all right, chat. Hold up. Jon Bois is great. I love me some Jon Bois. However, we need to take a look at this video.
He's a good-looking guy, but has always wanted to be taller. Now he's getting his chance thanks to groundbreaking limb-lengthening surgery, and we were there as he was rolled into the OR.
This guy is making a special trip to Las Vegas with his wife. He's not hoping to strike it rich. He's here to get taller.
If I can be taller, I want to be taller.
Ryan Wade is 5'7" tall.
Dude, that's not even that short. Society has gone too far on short jokes. The difference between 5'11 and 6 feet jokes have literally made a man break his legs to be a few inches taller. 5'9's average. Honestly, it would probably be cheaper just to just move to Japan. And then you're good. You're good, homie.
He's come to orthopedic surgeon Dr. Kevin Debbie Parshad for a groundbreaking limb-lengthening procedure.
After we've given you that additional height.
Well, the Philippines, you might be a giant there. They might look at you like a weirdo if you're 5'7", so maybe not there.
You'd probably be sitting very close to 5'11".
Yeah.
Okay.
The procedure involves implanting a steel device into the upper bone on both legs.
We use the remote control to slowly separate the bone. This is the remote control.
The remote control signals the device to pull the bones apart
1 millimeter
at a time.
I think that's pretty cool.
The body makes...
You think that's pretty cool? They did not show him this simulation before he said that. There's no way he looked at this simulation and went, yeah, that's pretty cool.
New bone to fill in the gap.
So I push this button, and then what happens?
Once you push the button, then that's when you start growing.
Awesome.
The cost, a whopping $75,000.
I've got another 70 years left on this planet, and I want to enjoy it to the full extent. And this is something, since I've been 14, that I've always wanted to do. $75,000 towards getting tall. I'm picking getting tall all the way.
Just use the $75,000 to fucking move if you're that insecure. 5'7 is literally, what is the average height? What is the average height? Average height, Japan. It's 5'2" for men. So, you're gonna be pretty fucking tall. No shot. I'm reading livejapan.com. They might not be the best source of it. But it says the average height. It's a bit young. Okay, never mind. Hold up. For some reason, it changed it. No, wait, what? Yeah, no, that's right. No, it's not. What? So it says the average height of a 17-year-old Japanese man. Okay, look. is 5'6", and then it's 5'1" for women, but when it comes to weight, yada yada. And then it says some people might be surprised that the average height is still relatively tall. According to Japan's National Health and Nutrition Survey, the average height was only 5'2". Oh, so I guess they got taller. They got taller. It's 5'6" now. That was 70 years ago. That's fair. Okay, that makes sense. Still above average, though. You're still an inch above average.
The 32-year-old is also tired of wearing shoe implants. The procedure will add 3 inches to Ryan's height. A huge difference.
Just don't wear them.
Yeah. Yeah. It's going to be pretty close to right there. Being taller than my wife is going to be, it'll be a treat.
At Sunrise Hospital and Medical Center, Teresa is confident.
I think he'll do great.
On his way to the OR,
what the fuck is he doing? He's going to pass out and then break his legs.
Ryan gets a good luck kiss.
I am super excited.
The doctor begins by taking...
Okay, hold up. Hold the phone here.
...taking precise measurements of Ryan's leg. Next, he drills into the bone, then surgically breaks the bone.
Okay, I'm going to paint an image of you of what this is. He has a hammer and what looks like a giant metal pen, and it's in the guy's leg, and he's just going like a construction man.
He creates a channel in the thigh bone for the implant.
So you can see it kind of going right down the center of the bone.
The implanted device is secured with screws that are drilled in above and below the break in the bone. He repeats the procedure on Ryan's other leg. Finally, the remote is tested to ensure the bone is separating. Success. Yeah,
the implant worked.
After 3 hours, Ryan is wheeled out of the OR. Dr. Debbie Parshad has good news.
So everything went very well?
Bend that knee.
Now, 3 months of grueling physical therapy begins.
That's stiff.
Ryan's muscles need to be stretched as his bones grow. Yeah.
It's hard work.
It was the most painful thing that I've ever gone through in my life.
David Wilson of Los Angeles had the same procedure last year. He was 5'7 and was stretched 2 inches to 5'9.
As my legs got longer, I needed to extend my seat back further so I could have this adjustment room right here. It was kind of cool.
And he had
75K to pull your seat back? Yeah, that is pretty cool. Hey, 75K, 6 months of physical therapy, and now I can pull my seat back. That's kind of cool.
As encouraging words for Ryan.
You're going to get back to normal pretty darn quick with this type of device and this technology. It's amazing.
Just 24 hours after surgery, Ryan is taking his very first steps and feels he's on his way to walking tall.
The procedure does not come cheap. The cost, a whopping $75,000.
That's insane. Okay, there's this. This is a. Can we even show this? Do I have someone who can quickly scroll through this? There's this. I wanted to watch this, but I actually on hindsight don't think we can. There's this documentary on this surgery because apparently it's omega popular to do in India to get taller. And so there's this 50-minute documentary on it, but I am concerned that it's going to have surgery scenes, which won't fly. Major TOS, skimmed it, zero shot. Okay, all right. We'll call it an L. We'll call it an L. I think it's too much surgery. My other one was much more wholesome. This was an interesting video that came out last week. And it was an in-depth look at how much money you make owning a ramen shop, which I thought was interesting. It seemed cool.
Hello, world. Ever since I made a mini documentary on what owning a ramen restaurant in Japan is like, I've thought to myself, how much money do ramen shops make?
What do you guys think? The problem with like a ramen shop is you can only serve and make as much money as people who are in your shop. And like the costs increase with every person that enters the shop. Which might, like, you might be like, yeah, no shit, Ludwig. But not all businesses function like that. That's how most businesses function, but, like, online, that's not how it functions. There's zero difference in cost for me to have 5 people watching my stream and then me having 50,000 people watching my stream. It costs me the same amount of money regardless. Because there is a cost, by the way. I don't know if you guys know. There's a difference in server costs for having 50,000 people watching live versus 5, but I don't pay for it. Twitch pays for that. Streaming pays for, like, the website host pays for that. It does cost Amazon more money, but they don't make me pay it. So all my costs are fixed, and it scales in, like, an amazing way. The only downfall of streaming is you cannot make money if you are not live, but if you had 500,000 people, it scales all the way up. Which is why you can have a guy like XQC who's probably spent like maybe, and this is stretching, maybe $5,000 on his entire stream setup. And he has like what? 4 million? $5 million? He does not need to pay more for his stream setup. I saw his old stream setup, dude. He literally didn't even have the AC on. There was like no changes that he had to make. But if you want a ramen shop that can now fit 50 people instead of 5, you have to pay so much more.
In Japan, ramen isn't a really expensive.
He has 72K viewers. He has a $10,000 PC, but he didn't pay for it. He got it free. That's what I mean. That's crazy. That's so crazy.
How much money do ramen shops make? In Japan, ramen isn't a really expensive food, and the owners of independent shops work long hours.
Oh, my guess, by the way, I feel like you make like, I think you make like 65K a year. Like profit. I would imagine. Maybe lower, but this is including employee salaries and all that, so this is what you walk away with. I would imagine it's like 65.
So is all the work worth it? To find out, I sat down with...
Hi, Koitani Takeshi desu.
He used to run several shops and now operates Rajuku Ramen School. First off, I wanted to know if it was hard to open up a shop.
だいたいそのラーメン店をまあオープンするのは簡単。
Chat our new business.
ただその続けるのがすごい難しい。
Mogul Ramen?
最初はやっぱりね、物珍しくてお客さんが来るけど、やっぱりそこで一番大事なのはファンを増やすってこと。
Koitani-san said you can set up a shop for 30 million yen, like 270,000 US dollars.
The homie said easy? Dude, I wouldn't call that easy. Like, it's not free. Easy to set up is like a Gmail account.
If you're buying everything and concerned about location and decor. But if you're taking over a place, not worried about location, and you're leasing equipment, you can start off for as little as 2 million to 3 million yen, which is like 18,000 to 27,000 US dollars. So it can be easy to open, but how many survive?
大体1年は持つってことだよね。その言っちゃえば 30% から 40% って。でも2年続けるのもっと半分になるとか 50% だから。で、3年持つ店はもっと厳しい。70%。
Dude. That's depressing. Not bad? What do you mean not bad? Some people are putting like 20K in or like a quarter million getting a business loan and then 70% of them just go away? Like, that's terrible. That's insanely terrible. There's a higher percent chance of being an absolute dumbass and going to Arizona State University and graduating. And they have a very low graduation percentage because they accept fucking everyone with a heartbeat. That's crazy. If you got worse odds than an Arizona State student, you're fucking up somewhere. Connor said turnover rates for restaurants are terrible. I believe that. What's more likely? Is it more likely to like keep a restaurant shop open for a few years or to actually finish a Nuzlocke run in one sitting? Like, I'm curious.
Those numbers sound fairly normal for the food industry, so no surprises there. But what if you're doing okay? What kind of numbers would a shop be looking at? Koitani-san shared with me what his shop, Saikoro, used to make. For his 11-seater, it pulled in 5,500,000 yen a month. And after expenses, that leaves about 510,000 yen.
Wait. This was an 11-seat, 220 bowl a day. It's like a video game if your business operates based off of bowls per day. that's like what they do in Overcooked. Yeah, my BPD took kind of a dip. You know, the COVID bounced back, my BPD shot up, but then all of a sudden, you know, people went back to the big dogs, the Amazons. Ingredients cost $15,000 a month. Just on ingredients. That's a third of all costs. I remember one time I worked at this pizza shop. This is my first job I ever had. I was 16 years old. And my boss, Pete, old as shit. Sweetheart, though. And I was like talking to him because it was a slow day. And I was like, how much does it actually cost to make a pizza? Because I was curious. You know, we charged something like $12 if you got a pizza. And I was like, how much would it cost to actually make it? Like with just the ingredients. And he was like offended. You know, he spoke in an old raspy voice. He's like, you don't do it like that. It's not, what do you mean just the ingredients? You got to add the rent. I got to pay you to make the pizza. You're not considering that I also have to do overturn. It's not just the pepperoni. You can go out and buy pepperoni. It's a dollar. But if you go out and you get this pizza, the oven, everything to cook it, it's not, you can't. And he never told me, like, basically what is the cost and then what is the margins and then what is the profit. But it is interesting to see that basically a third of all the money spent goes into ingredients. Staff is the largest. That makes a lot of sense. Employee salaries are so expensive. Like paying people to live. It's expensive. Because you have like the salary. I think it's like, I only know about this because I had to figure out all the salaries for my employees recently. And Slime was telling me that it's like, you basically have to take whatever number you want to pay them and then multiply it by like 1.25. Because that includes like basically like the full benefits, the accounting, like all the extra shit that comes in with hiring someone that isn't just the money they receive. So if you pay someone like, you know, $100,000, it'll actually cost you like $125,000 or something like that. And I think it can be higher. I don't need exact numbers.
Right now, that's like $4,600. I thought that wasn't bad, but then he said he'd take his salary from that profit. It's very common for owners to work 6 days a week.
Wait, so he's making $4,600 a month? Wait, so my guess was 65K. He's making like 55. Wait, that's a day? He's fucking loaded. No, that's definitely a month, right? Yeah, yeah. Okay, you guys are throwing me off. You do 4,600 times 12, 55K. But he said he doesn't take the full thing.
His salary from that profit. It's very common for owners to work 6 days a week, more than 12 hours a day. So if you think about someone working over 300 hours a month, that's not a lot of pay for all the work and risk that's being taken.
No shot.
And what if you're not doing so well? Are you making less than minimum wage? Two distinct types that I'm in.
Okay, make fun of me for 2 days. You know the entire plot to like Spirited Away was 2 days? Okay, a lot of shit can happen in 2 days.
Shops, corporate chains, and independents.
今だい、あの、個人店が結構増えてて、まあ、だいたい 60% ぐらい占めて。
I'm hungry, I want ramen.
あとチェーン店が 40% ぐらい。これがまあ20年前ぐらいだと逆だったような気がしますね。やっぱりあの、
Wait, that's good.
ラーメン店を自分でチェーン店とかで加盟しないで
I'd rather more places be independent.
っていう人が増えた。あと作れる人が増えたっていうのかな。昔20年前ぐらいっていうのはそのインターネットでラーメンの情報とかレシピっていうのをあんまりこう頻繁に見れるような時代じゃなかった。今は SNS でも、YouTube でもラーメンの、ね、レシピとか作り方っていうのは見れる。
You're telling me homies are going on YouTube looking up how to make ramen and then opening a restaurant?
で、まあ実際に作れる人が増えたっていうの。
People are going to How To Basic, then drop in $250,000 on a restaurant. This dude in Japan's like, yeah, no, I saw a How To Basic video. It was confusing, but I'm pretty sure this is how you make it. A lot of eggshells for whatever reason, but, you know, we'll get there.
そこが大きいと思いますね。個人店の方が比率的に多くなったっていうのは。
So it's easier than ever to learn how to make ramen.But who are these people who want to open up their own ramen shops?
Crazy な人多いよね。ラーメンの店主。
Psychopaths。
そういう人は多いかもしれない。12時間当たり前だと個人店はね。うん。ラーメンが本当好きだから何時間働いても、うん。でも個人店は意外とそういう人が多いかもしれないね。そう考えて、まあ、
I don't think I've ever loved the food enough. 絶対
自分しかやんない。スタッフを信用してないっていうのはあると思う。あとトッピングとかはスタッフに多少やらしたりとかね。教えて任せて味が落ちるのが嫌だから、まあ自分でやる。店主一人で全部やるっていう人が多いと思う。
I think it's dumb as bricks. I feel like people who are, I feel like it's a, you know, like I used to be like, oh yeah, that makes sense. You're the only one that can do it. But it's so heavy on the ego. You know what I mean? Like how...egocentrical or how self-absorbed you have to be that you think you are the bottleneck, it literally could not be made without you. I understand that it's hard and you could certainly could find bad employees that would fuck it up. Streamers and YouTubers do this same exact thing. Streamers and YouTubers consistently think they are the only ones who can edit their video or they are the only ones who are like able to like basically form what ends up beinga stream, or a YouTube video, and then they're like the bottleneck. They can only upload as much as they do. That was literally you. No. I passed off editing work very quickly, but like maybe you're talking about titling and thumbnailing. To be fair, you're right. I still do all my titling and thumbnailing, which is kind of like being at the end of the ramen line after it's made and going,Yep, that's good. And then pushing it along. Like, I'm not doing that much. Titling and thumbnailing is important, but, you know, it's not that time-consuming compared to editing. But I'm also trying to find someone. Shake will back me up in chat. I've literally been trying to find someone to do thumbnails for me for the past 6 months. But I don't think I have found someone. So I'm not saying it's easy to find someone, but I'm also not in my own head enough to think that I am the person to do it. I think I'm dumb.Like, I don't think I am technically good at Photoshop. I think I'm bad at Photoshop. But I do think that I know what I want, like a YouTube video should look like more than most people. So I'm trying to find someone. I think I want to do a contest where I maybe do a YouTube video to find my next thumbnail person. Like, maybe just do a contest of what...video it is and like have someone do you know kind of like the Photoshop this image green screen thing yeah basically a train wreck giveaway and not pay 99% of the people and then get one person and give them a full-time job that's what the winner gets yeah pretty much
right so the broth and Woo! Tare our seasoning are the core of how ramen will taste and owners want it exactly the way they want it so they only trust themselves our long-term employees to make these crucial components
makes sense
but why not make a bunch of broth and tare in a huge batch and keep it for a week
ラーメンの種類スープの種類によって違います、うん、やっぱり毎日作った方が美味しいスープもあれば少し熟成させた方が美味しいスープもあるし で、冷蔵庫でスープストックしても変わんない。
That's what ramen is when it coagulates. Isn't that gross? Some of you guys are still craigasming over this.
スープもある。
Pure fat, let's go.
スープ2本、ああ、全部で3本ですね。魚、鶏、あと濃厚の豚のスープ。で、魚は毎日やってて、で、鶏のスープは2日に1回ですね。鶏のスープやって、で、次の日にその濃厚の方。
結構こういう質問を受けるとさ、みんなこう、ラーメン知らない人は、ラーメンって1つだと思ってるから。
Imagine one type of ramen broth. Rookies.
So because there's multiple broths that can take all day to make.
Tonkatsu, fish, sucking my nuts. There's a lot of ramen people don't know about.
And chefs want control over them. Working 12 hours a day or more, 6 days a week is very common. I've even heard about chefs who sleep overnight at their kitchen to watch over broth. I don't even pretend to know what makes a good bowl of ramen. So I think a lot of people like me will say, What about the noodles?
大体のラーメン店は製麺屋さんから麺を買う。まあなんで買うかっていうと人件費がかからないっていうのと、そうね、あとは製麺機を買うコストが。
Pre-made noodles.
Right. He showed me his noodle machine and told me that it cost about 2 million yen or $18,000 to get it. But another big cost is the space, since you need a special room separate from the kitchen to control the process. Then once you have accounted for those costs, you still have the staff and ingredients to pay for. And then is your staff going to be able to make noodles that are better than the factories? But still, there are pros to having your own noodle machine.
で、自家製麺をやることのメリットっていうのは、やっぱり原価。製
麺所
から麺を買うより安く麺が作れる。あとは、まあ、クオリティ。どうしても製麺所から買う麺っていうのは、保存料とか、そういうものが入ってるから、お客さんに。
I feel like it's only good because then you could just say, I made my own noodle, and that's it. Like, if I saw a place that said homemade noodles, or noodles made in-house ramen shop, I would be like, oh, that's hype. And that's pretty much the only reason.
麺作ってますよ。まあそこでこだわりのお店っていうことが伝えられるから、そのメリットも大きいかな。自分のスープに合う麺を自分の好みで作れる。
The biggest problem that a ramen shop owner faces is probably something that you'll be able to guess. But I found the reasons why to be fascinating.
I don't know it. I don't guess it. The biggest issue is probably hiring staff.
一番の課題はやっぱり人材じゃないですかね。人材を、確保するだけでも難しいけど、まあその人材を教育していく。
I'm the problem.
育てていくっていうのはすごい大変なことだと。
I'm the problem because I worked at a ramen shop for 2 days and then I left. I'm literally the problem. I'm sorry, mister. That's everywhere right now. I assume the ramen turnaround has always been hard. I mean, look, here's the thing, man. I worked at a ramen shop for 2 days. I made $12.50 an hour. It was really fucking hot. The floor was super slippery. I was wearing knockoff Yeezys because they told me to bring black shoes. And the only pair of black shoes I owned were knockoff Yeezys, which I did not know were knockoff Yeezy when I purchased them. I just bought online black shoes and they happened to be knockoff Yeezys. I just thought they looked cool. This is a true story. I'm kind of embarrassed about it. I got called out for it at a college class. It was really embarrassing. And they slipped like no other. I almost fell like 15 times. It was super fucking hot. I got one 30-minute break, and the break was pretty much just scarfing down a free ramen bowl that I got, which was cool that I got free food. Outside of that, you just sit there, and you constantly have a flow of work to do. And then I left exhausted, and I couldn't do anything for the rest of the night because I was so tired. And then I got a job at Best Buy, which paid $12.50. I sat around for 99% of the day because nobody fucking wanted a mobile phone plan. I just told people where they would find the iPhones. Sat around, made $12.50, went home, felt full of energy, streamed 4 hours. So it's just like you're not really getting paid for all the additional work you're putting in compared to like the demand of a retail job. Tips. Yeah, I mean, I was not getting tips. Ramen is like a 5-step process. Like you get a bowl, you put oil in it, you put the sauce in it, you put some type of fat in it, then you put some type of sauce in it. So like, you know, some oil, some soy sauce, whatever. Then you put the broth, then you cook the noodles, then you put the garnishes. And I was in a train line, literally just doing the first part where I would just get the bowl prepared and I would just put like, okay, this oil, this sauce, then I'd pass it along. And that was all I do. This oil, this sauce, pass it along. There was no like beautiful art to it, and I was not getting paid tips for that part.
修行するっていう文化があるから、やっぱりね、その従業員にもスタッフにも少し仕事を与えないとなかなかね、覚えられないし、5年以上いればもう完全ね、店任してっていう感じにもできると思うけど、みんなもう1年も持たずに辞めちゃう人多いから、今のラーメン業界は。
Makes sense?
で少し覚えたら次の店行ってでまた1年ぐらいやって次の店行ってで次独立みたいな、うん、でそういう人に全部教えちゃったらさ、うん、だから教えない店主が多いと思う、
That makes sense. That's the offline TV problem. Everyone who you bring in to work for you secretly wants to become a ramen chef. So you put all the tools and efforts into teaching them and then they become their own ramen chef.Except the offline TV problem is you're bringing in people to work for you and then they all want to become content creators. No, it's not a race joke, you idiots. Like offline TV has a problem where everyone who wants to work for them secretly wants to become a content creator. Something happens with that. That same thing happens with me as well. Like people will ask to work for me, but secretly they just want to become a content creator. They want to be a streamer or YouTuber, but they're like, I'll do any job. You don't have to pay me.And it's like, okay, well, if I literally wanted you to do a job like editing or something, your secret back goal is to become a content creator. So all the tools and efforts I put into making you a phenomenal editor would just result in you wanting to be a content creator. I don't think it's every job ever because usually jobs have a way to grow in a ladder system where you become like, you can grow within the system. Does that make sense?I mean, like Best Buy, to make an example, is like you can end up being a general manager of a store. You don't leave to start your own Best Buy. That's not, that'd be fucking hype. You know, I would respect that, but you don't do that. That's why I like, you know, Shake. Shake, I don't think has ever been trying to spin his editing gig into becoming an influencer. Slime, Nick, Aiden.If they all wanted to be influencers, then I would immediately lose them as employees. Well, I guess Nick's not one, but, you know, who knows what happened to the yard if they did their own thing, if they try to spin off the yard.
Seems like a bit of a self-fulfilling prophecy. Owners don't have staff they can trust to run the shop because they think it takes 3 to 5 years to be able to trust that person.But the staff who are motivated to learn want to suck in as much info as possible and thus try to hop from shop to shop, learning what they can before they open up a shop of their own. So shops don't want to teach staff how to do everything, and thus they don't get staff that can do everything.
Makes sense.
Let's talk about the cost of a bowl of ramen and why they're usually under 1,000 yen or $9. But to explain that, we have to go back for a mini history lesson.Because we can't physically go back in time, we're doing the closest thing and visiting the Shin Yokohama Ramen Museum.
Oh, shit.
スタートがやっぱり歴史が長いでしょ日本のラーメンっていうのは。戦後からとかさ、食糧難の時から本来捨てるようなガラ、ね、豚の骨とか鶏ガラでや、ね、野菜入れてとか、お金かけずに美味しいものを作ってきたっていう歴史があるから、やっぱりそんなに取れない。
So this is part of why I wondered how ramen and even more affordable Japanese noodle dishes like udon and soba could be double the price overseas. I'm sure some of it must be ingredients and operation costs, but this is what Koitani-san had to say.
海外の場合はもうスタートがやっぱり安い時代がないじゃない、言っちゃえば。だから海外は高く設定しても取れる。
But still, it felt...
Wait, so I'm getting fucking scammed? When they charge me $15 for a bowl of ramen, the only reason they're doing it is because they've never charged cheap amounts. So I don't know that it's secretly cheap. And if I went to Japan, they'd be like, oh, yeah, it's 600 yen, homie. God damn.
To me that when people make good food in Canada and they have
scammed.
Lineups out the door, they can raise prices. It's the normal thing to do.
ね、ラーメンってそんなにまだ文化的に風潮的にっていうのかな、なんか安い食べ物みたいなのあるから、だから倍には上げられないよね。だけどまあ一つの1000円の壁っていうのがあって、まあ怖いのもあるんじゃない。値上げしすぎてお客さんが離れちゃう。だって。
$10 max?
Many articles I've read state that there are 10,000 ramen shops in Tokyo alone. I have no clue if that number is true, but it does seem safe to say there's a lot of competition.
まだ600円とかのお店もあるからね、下町だとね。650円とか。
That's crazy.
ラーメンって意外とそのぐらいの値段で食べれるラーメンが一番ラーメンらしくて美味しい。やっぱりこう
1 gallon of gas or a bowl of ramen?
食材にこだわるでしょ。そうするとなんかラーメンじゃないようなものになっちゃうっていうか、その1000円のギリギリのとこまで値上げするっていうのはやっぱりただ利益出したいとかじゃなくて、やっていくうちにもっといい食材を使いたいとか、うん、もっと美味しくしたいっていう意味で原価がかかってしまうから値上げするお店が多いかな。
Even though Koi,
how expensive is gas? It's not that bad. It's like $4.50 or something. It is stupid though. I went and I bought gas and I put $20. I had cash only, so I was like, "Hey, can I get $20 on the pump?" And the guy was like, "Yeah." And then I filled the pump, and then my tank wasn't even a quarter full. And I was like, "I'm not like driving a truck. I don't have like 15, 20 gallons in there. It's like a 13-gallon tank." And I was like, "God damn, bro, that barely filled up." It'd be like $65 to like fill my entire tank. It's expensive as fuck, yeah. It's $5.50 in downtown SF. Yeah, it's fucking, it's a little crazy, man.
Koitani-san's explanations about pricing make sense. It still feels incredible to me that shops with lines outside their doors will keep their prices at or below the 1,000 yen wall. And I guess that explains why, for ramen chefs in Japan, it's more about the passion than the money.
まあ今ラジュクは、
It's kind of cool.
海外の人、外国人の人オンリーで、授業をやってます。
Yeah, if you're gonna try to make money with the food in Japan, ramen does not seem like the strat. It's like opening up a burger shop in America. I guess Mr. Beast literally did that though. Mr. Beast did enter the most saturated market and somehow come out thriving.
Thanks for watching. See you next time. Peace. So, do you think it's worth it to open up a ramen shop in Japan?
No shot. Sounds fucking miserable. I don't think I've ever loved a food enough to do all the work to just create one meal, you know? Like, what food do you love that much that's the one thing you will create? It's not like a restaurant where you can make many different dishes. Beef Wellington. Like, you show up like a katsudon and you just have beef Wellington. Pizza. Pizza shop. Pizza shop I can bite. I think if it was me, I'd make a bakery. That's like the one thing. I don't think I'd ever get sick of just being a bakery guy. Just making sick bread. Bread is so cool in Pog. I'm the pizza guy. I'm kind of a fake pizza guy. I'll give myself that. I'm a bit fraudulent. I made a few pizzas and I kind of quit since then. I would like to do some super auto pets, but Not yet. Not just yet, chat. I want to do a little more reaction, Andrew. Someone said there's a subreddit all about shitty jobs. When I was talking about leaving my ramen job. Anti-work? Is this like a fun subreddit or is this like a sad subreddit? This is sad and not fun. Because I thought it'd be like comically bad job situations. Because I kind of want to do a Reddit review. We haven't done a Reddit review in a minute where we go through all the top posts from a subreddit. Who's the boss now? Where you at, Chris? Question mark. You told Mark you could work the night shift. No, I didn't. I told Mark I couldn't work Monday. You told him you couldn't work in the morning, but you could work normal hours. As you know, I found out my dad died yesterday. Hey, been there. I'm going to go ahead and at least take the one day off and I get a week to mourn his death. I'm sorry for any inconvenience this will cause you. My uncle died a few days ago. I lost my grandma. Stop being a victim. Mail me my check. I quit and go fuck yourself. Yeah, that's pretty good. That's, you know, that's pretty, that's a pretty fair exchange. That's a pretty fair, just kind of batshit crazy response. Thrown out that my grandma died? Like, what is that? What is that even? What is that supposed to mean? That's like saying my president is black before saying the worst sentence that you could possibly say in your life. 8 years ago. My grandma. This happened at IHOP. Crazy. Yeah, you know, this doesn't seem as fun of one. Tales from retail might be fun. Tales from retail. This just seems like stories of working at retail, right? Nah, not as fun, not as fun, not as fun, not as fun. YouTube haiku. What? Is it just YouTube videos? Short ones. Wait, this sounds amazing. Let's do this. Let's do a little Reddit review on this one. Food, and I wanted ramen, but the only ramen place open. Let me tell you, Uber Eats is psychopathic. I went to order ramen, and it says this store is closing in 4 minutes. Hurry up. What do you think I'm gonna fucking do? Put an order in with 2 minutes remaining and have them go, all right, hey, we're gonna have to stay open an extra 30. We just got to make this real quick and then wait for the delivery driver. Insane. They should have like a 30-minute early cutoff for like ordering apps, maybe even 45. They actually do already do that. I still feel like shit ordering before the cutoff, so I'm not gonna. I'm even concerned about this cutoff. Although it's smart that they do that. Anyway, boys, it's been a while since we've done this. This is a Reddit review where we look at the top posts of all time in a specific subreddit. And as you guys know, I've come and I've gone to the great state of Arizona to get 2 degrees. And I would argue every day I use my journalism degree when I deliver you guys the news. Like, boys, I hit 2 million subs. Or, boys, I almost got banned for showing boobs in an anime on stream. But today, I would like to flex my English major by studying some poetry, specifically haikus, YouTube haikus, which I think are actually just short, funny, hilarious videos, which is the dream for any human on Earth. It's like the greatest consumption of content is short, funny videos. So let's take a look. I don't really know this subreddit well.
They pushed me out and paced me.
Okay, classic. I believe this was, if you don't get the reference, this was a day after January 6th, where there was a woman there. Well, you should be able to connect the rest of the dots there. Next, let's keep it moving, baby.
I think you just whispered to me. From now on, when you whisper, I will whisper back.
Oh, you're you can a dirty bitch.
Turn
oh
off whispering.
I love this video.
Alexa.
I'd rather
fart for me.
Okay, here's big fart.
Oh,
that was a deep one.
Oh, yeah.
Shall I play another fart sound?
Yeah, give me another one. Come on.
Oh. That was...
That's good. That's just good content. You can't say female viewership if trending downwards. Here's the thing about women... As gross as men.
Can a low come up in your crib?
Man, fuck you, nigga. I see you at work.
I don't hate me because I'm beautiful, nigga. Maybe if you got rid of...
Holy shit, I just realized this is not a video game.
...ass haircut you got to get some bitches on your dick. Nah, better yet, maybe Tanisha will call your dog ass and she quit fucking with that brain surgeon the lawyer she fucking with. Nigga...
The framing for that's insane. Whoever filmed that did an amazing job. That's like 1-to-1 with the actual GTA line. The Elder Joes 5.
Hello.
Okay. I thought there was going to be a lot more to that. That was great. When cops mix up their weapons at home.
You little rascal.
This is a terrible start to a video. I don't want to watch this one. I don't want to watch this one, do I?
Squirt me, daddy! You little rascal! Oh no!
Squirt me, daddy!
I'm gonna get.
He cocks it. Oh shit! Oh fuck! I forgot and I accidentally cocked it. That's good. Hey, the YouTube comment section on this is probably fire right now. Oh, Sag. Hey. And if it wasn't, let's throw in another president.
We are right president. About the fraud. Joe Biden can't be president. We're talking about hundreds of thousands of votes. We're talking about numbers like nobody has ever seen before.
We. Okay. Good one. Owned. Dog picking up and eating tomato from garden. Oh, that shit gonna explode in your mouth. Nature's gusher. Oh, okay, yeah, that was as promised. 20 million views. This is more successful than anything I have ever created on YouTube to a magnitude of 4. Almost 5. By the way, if you guys have never tried a homegrown tomato and you hate tomatoes, you've never tried a tomato. You should think like that. Store-bought tomatoes are literally a different fruit than tomatoes you grow at home. Or that are like more naturally grown. They're literally a different fruit. You might as well have never had a tomato before. Fruit? Oh. Did you guys think they were vegetables? No, you dumb fucks. You didn't. You didn't actually think tomatoes were vegetables. You rookies. Absolute sheep. Oh, my God.
Whoa. Ministry of Information have decided to send me to USA, greatest country in the world.
What type of dog is this?
Hey, cafe!
Come on and make my day, asshole.
You look like a cocksucker of meat.
Very nice. How much?
That was great. I liked every second of that video. Oh, Hikaru?
I can also trade and take and take and if takes, I take. If takes, 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 queen e2. Queen h4, g3, knight g3, check, c6, queen b7, knight h1, king there. I don't know what's going on. I'm just going to castle. I don't want to think too much.
Good one. Call of Duty lobby speedrun. I know this one. This one is a bit of a slur. I will skip this one, but it is insane. Obi-Wan Kenobi at Disney HQ, and it's the mom from Big Hero 6 or the aunt when they gave her a giant booba. Is this chill? You think this is probably fine? It's probably fine.
Hi.
Do you think I can get away with this on Twitch? It's probably fine.
Hey, guys. Look at my little college man. I can't wait to hear all about it.
Are you sure you have the right coordinates?
According to my information, it should appear in this quadrant here.
I hate to say it, but it looks like the system you're searching for doesn't exist.
Impossible. Perhaps the archives are incomplete.
Okay. That was actually not that bad. Yeah, if you go to the original scene, they don't look like that. Although I did hear they're making a sequel to the Big Hero 6. I think I heard that. I think I saw that. I never watched the trailer. Is it actually called Big Hero 7? No, they're just making a movie called Baymax. Right. I see. That was the trailer. Oh, it's a TV show? Oh, that's lame. It should still be cool, though. Keanu Reeves is extremely horny.
If I need your body, I'll fuck it.
Okay. All right. That was fair enough. Elizabeth from Knoxville.
Ma'am, what happened to you?
I got maced.
You got maced.
Please.
And what happened? You were trying to go inside the Capitol?
Yeah, I made it like a foot inside, and they pushed me out, and they maced me.
What's your name? Where are you from?
My name is Elizabeth. I'm from Knoxville, Tennessee.
And why did you want to go in?
We're storming the Capitol. It's a revolution.
Thank you.
Damn. The Americans in 1776? I don't know. He just fucking, like, shot me with a musket and took a long time to reload, so I went home. I thought we were going to make America happen, but I guess we're still England. What? Grubhub commercial, but it's only the good parts. Okay. All right. You got me there. You boomed me. Good one. You can make that same video and have like 30 on your channel and just change the title to Mizkif stream, but only the good parts. Ludwig stream, but only the good parts. And you will consistently get a lol W out of their chat.
Who thinks Watson is too heavy? Raise your hand if you think he's too heavy. Does anybody think he's too skinny? No. Okay. So I'm very proud of you guys. You got 100%. He's perfect.
Yeah! Woo! You may not like it, but this is what the ideal doggo looks
Who
like.
Who thinks Watson is too heavy?
He does look perfect. What a perfect dog. Golden retrievers are the best dog.
What's up? Can a G come up in your crib? Ah, don't hate me, because I'm gorgeous, Freeman. Maybe if you got rid of that old yee-yee-ass AGV suit, you'd get some bitches on your dick. Hmm? Oh, better yet, maybe Alex will call you head crab ass if she ever stops fucking with that Vortigaunt or scientist she fucking with. Freeman.
Extreme heat damage detected.
Well, you know, if you solve, there's a $7,000 jackpot. Go ahead.
Shaggy and Scooby-Doo.
Whoa! I'm impressed. Thank you.
That's crazy.
I have just one thing to say to you.
That's a classic. The camera guy during the weekend's halftime show. This is from a Super Bowl.
Chill, bro. What the fuck are you doing?
It's an outdated meme, but it's still funny. Play catch.
Hey, Dad, I was just wondering if you wanted to go outside and toss around the... Hey, Dad, I was just wondering if you wanted to go outside and play some catch. You got this. Sorry, buddy, I'm just really busy right now. I'd love to, buddy. Sorry, but I'm just really busy right now.
This guy's funny. I've seen this guy on TikTok a bunch. There's like a... I don't know what to call them. You know? Because there's like comedy groups that come up and then they're like labeled with a name that makes it sound cool. But I don't know what to call these guys. There's like a subsect of like 5 or 6... hilarious, awkward, cringe, 130 soaking wet white guys on TikTok who are hilarious. I don't know if you can come up with a cool name for these guys, but they are out there and they are killing it. I wonder if I can find the guy. Nah, shit. Do anyone know the TikTok I'm trying to think of right now? This is another guy who's on TikTok who does well as well. Who does that well as well. Although his TikTok isn't on YouTube. What are you talking about? Wait, what? What are you talking about? Okay. It was a big fail. I was like, that's crazy. I can't believe she left. That's it. Okay. I get clickbait out of my mind, and all of a sudden, I'm the guy who's getting exposed out here. I can't believe I just got exposed by my red bar. It was crazy. I also saw another one with Sid, I think, and I was like, I watched that one too. I was like, this is crazy. How's this a thing? And then I found out some other streamers like to play guitar, and I was like, that's cool. I like to play guitar too. Uh, All right, let me see if I can find this. That Martin kid. This is one of the best TikToks.
What do I do for a living? I play video games for strangers on the internet. Yeah, I know. Do you know what Twitch is? Yeah, I'm a streamer on Twitch, exactly. I've been streaming for about 2 years now. Yeah, so I have an audience about 10 to 15... What do I do for a living?
That guy. He's one of, like, the five. One of the five goated people of being incredibly awkward and uncomfortable on TikTok right now. Okay. What next? Dr. Fauci confirms the existence of mutants.
What is it about these mutants that you're hearing about? The mutants in the UK, which we know are in about 20 plus states, the mutants that we're seeing in South Africa and in Brazil.
Is mutant the correct word for a mutation? Thank you, Tara. Glad to hear it, man. I'm glad you had a fun time. I'm bummed I couldn't go to that. Marijuana.
Steven, what are you doing in there?
Drugs.
I've never seen the original. Pulp Fiction, but with smiles. Shalat's Instagram. All right. Yeah, good one. TOS. Yeah, man. Who could forget that documentary with Bruce Willis in it? Spoilers. If you have not yet watched Pulp Fiction and you are currently watching my stream, you are too far gone. I do not care. You have been in my stream for the last 2 hours instead of watching Pulp Fiction. I do not care about that. I'm not going to. I cannot coddle you. You have made too many wrong decisions in life. You are too far gone. I can't believe I got gotten in 2021. Almost 2022. Now you
try. First, get a jar. Patrick, that's a blue-eyes white dragon.
Yes.
That's crazy, dude. What a crazy thing you've created. Usher's cat, yeah, is cat's meow. Fire. Poetry opening the door to a boss fight.
Hi, I'm Maddie, recruitment vice president.
I'm Haley, chapter president.
I'm Jean Marie, formal recruitment chair.
We've been waiting for you all summer, and we're so glad you're finally here.
Dude, I'd feel so bad if I was in that sorority when that was a hot meme. Like, you couldn't go a second on the internet without seeing that video and being horrified. Wait, Kyle's dating one of them? No. Kyle, a mod in my chat, is dating one of them. No! One of them or an 80 Pi? Because there's a difference. If he's dating an 80 Pi, that's fine. It's like a literal global network. There are 80 Pis everywhere. One of the girls in the video? I want to call him and ask, but, you know, this is like his girlfriend that he probably like loves dearly. I don't want to like insult. I'll ask breezily.
Hello.
Hey, Kyle.
Hey, Ludwig. How are you?
Hey, I'm live on Twitch, Kyle. I'm doing well. How are you?
I'm doing well. Getting ready, you know,
yeah,
for the next day.
Okay. So you're just getting your evening sorted?
Oh, yeah.
Are you alone, Kyle? Or are you with someone?
Yeah, I'm alone.
Okay. I have a question for you.
Uh-huh.
Do you happen to be in a relationship right now?
Yep.
Is your girlfriend an 80 Pi?
You found out?
I just found out.
How did you just find out? I told, like, everyone. Like, wow.
Well, I think it's because the timelines. Because I forgot about this video until I just saw it again. And I assume the relationship... Was it happening before the video came out?
Oh, no.
Yeah.
Like, that was, like, the first thing she said on the date.
Really? It was, like, the intro?
No, it was, like, 2 hours in.
She was like, I'm in an 80 Pi video, and you're like, I'm in Tempe Late Night.
Yeah. I was like, I'm a Ludwig mod, and she was like, who? So.
Okay, yeah, fair enough. She's an 80 Pi, you're a Ludwig mod. It's a match made in heaven.
Exactly.
Is she horrified of this video in this day?
No, she thinks it's funny.
It is funny. Is she one of the girls in the back?
Oh, no,
clapping?
She's awake.
Wait, she is there?
Do you want to talk to her?
Yeah, I'll say hi. I'd love to. What's her name?
Okay. Jean Marie.
Jean Marie. It's a very Texan mm-hmm. name.
It's Ludwig.
Oh.
Hello, Jean Marie.
Hi, how's it going?
It's going great. How are you?
I'm good.
Is this a horrifying thing that I'm bringing up? I just saw your video and found this out and had to call Kyle.
No, I think it's really funny.
Okay, Jean, where are you in the video? Where can I freeze frame and see you?
At any point, I'm in the front. I'm the one that says I'm Jean Marie.
Wait. You're the middle. You're the main girl.
Yeah.
You're the main girl.
It makes it so good. If you go on if you go on my Facebook, there's a really good, my cover photo is a great still. That's like
Jean Marie, it's
Jordan
2021.
Peele.
I haven't been on Facebook in 3 years. I just have to keep this stack. You throw that on Twitter though, and I'm looking at it day one. Maybe in the metaverse, I'll take a look. That's so you just think it's funny now, right?
Yeah. No, it's been funny for like as soon as it happened.
That's so crazy. Okay, can you admit this to me? Did Kyle ever bring up that he was a Ludwig moderator?
Oh, yeah.
No. Did he?
He did, yeah.
On
no,
like the first date?
Did he say it on the first date? I definitely brought up the meme on the first date.
I think I said something, but it was like 2019.
Do you want to go on?
So, yeah.
Yeah,
I mod
like
for a guy called Ludwig.
Dating.
Oh, that was a while ago then. All right, we were
yeah. Yeah, yeah. You were a nice off. It was like December 2019, so you were like a nice 4K. Oh, not 4K. You were pretty.
I was chugging along with, you know, I had a few. It was nothing extraordinary.
Yeah, you had definitely blown up bigger than I ever thought possible.
Okay, a little bit informative. A little bit too informative there. I was, you know, people call me top 10 funniest on Tempe Late Night in my seasons.
Oh, I heard that.
of the eight people there.
How many?
Well, that's insane. This is great. Well, you know, hopefully I'm able to, we can all catch up sometime and get a dinner perhaps and, you know, recreate the video and all that good fun.
Ooh.
Yeah, absolutely. As long as it's for content, right, Ludwig?
Yeah, well, never. Kyle, we don't hang out for pleasure anymore these days. That's not how it works.
Oh, I know.
Well, you know, sorry to keep you guys, sorry to wake you, first of all. I heard you awoke here.
I was awake.
She was chilling.
All right. Okay. All right. Well, thanks for answering, Kyle. I love you. I hope you guys have a great rest of your evening.
Yeah, love you too.
All right. Bye, guys.
Bye.
That's crazy, dude. That's the craziest coincidence I have ever seen ever. Kyle, my friend from college, now my mod, and also the other many things he is in life and a great man, dating the centerfold, Jean Marie. That's crazy. Time been around that chick. I was going to do the AD Pie song, but I couldn't think of it in time. So, you know Twitch? Making video games for like a living? Yeah, I moderate that channel. Yeah, I'm the reason the streets are clean, I guess you could say. You want to watch me ban someone now? Everybody made fun of the Ludwig mods until the subathon rolled around and they all copped 10K. And then all of a sudden, everyone was like, wait, how do I become one of the moderators?
What do you do when you wake up in the morning and you're sick with the blues instead of the flus?
Go to work anyway?
No, stupid. You're going to take a mental health day, but tell your boss that you're actually sick so that they don't think you're weak in the head.
Oh, that's too bad. What are your symptoms?
I don't have to tell you that.
Good work. Now all you gotta do is sit back, relax, and feel guilty about doing this for the rest of the day.
Doesn't sound that hype. That sounds pretty shite. Yeah, that's, you know. I've a couple of times, I think it's only happened like twice, maybe three times, but I've directly lied about why I couldn't stream. I was like, shit, boys, fellas, something came up, couldn't get it done. In reality, I just did not want to stream. It does not happen that often. It does not happen that often, but it's happened a couple times. Cutie has ratted me out on that before. Like, one time I didn't stream because I wanted to finish Code Geass, and then I cried after Code Geass ended, and I wanted to just sit in the moment of having watched Code Geass. So I didn't stream. But I'm not gonna at the Discord and be like, guys, I cried watching Code Geass anyway. I can't stream today. So I had to fucking lie. Plain and simple. Midwestern.
Excellent waiter. Choice tonight, sir. This is our finest vintage.
That'll do.
A taste, sir.
Please.
Ooh. Fancy.
Great legs.
This, of course, is from the Valley region.
Napa?
No, actually, hidden.
Exquisite.
Just tell me when, sir. Perfect. Excellent. And we'll leave you with a dessert menu.
Good one. Rolled and smoked, all those Midwestern fools. Ranch on pizza, I will never be a fan of. I will never understand ranch on people, pizza people. Psychopaths in my mind. It doesn't make sense to me. You're not even eating pizza. You're just using pizza as a vehicle for ranch. Just have bread and ranch next time. Like, what are you wasting? You're wasting the rest of the pizza on ranch. Just get, like, chicken McNuggets and eat ranch or something. It's just stupid to do it on pizza. Siri is having a stroke in the car.
In 1.4 miles, take the exit onto I-80. onto I-80.
Good one. Booba in the thumbnail?
I thought I heard you. Hi.
Hey.
Oh, look at my little college man.
Where are they? Where are they?
What do you say to that, you freak? Well, if I wanted to kill myself, I'd climb up your ego level. What do you say to that, you freak? Well, if I wanted to kill myself, I'd climb up your ego level and jump down to your IQ level and kill.
Dude, come on, YouTube, please.
What do you say to that, you freak? What do you say to that, you freak? Well, if I wanted to kill myself, I'd climb up your ego level and jump down to your IQ level and kill myself. What? If I wanted to kill myself.
Nobody told you to kill yourself.
I would just climb.
No, don't say it again.
Yes, sir.
Did you write that? I mean, is that from something?
I made it up.
Well, for that, I am gonna have to beat the shit out of you now.
Thanks, Reddit.
That is a dog shit insult. You're much better off just saying you're ugly. It'll hurt more in the long run. You're ugly and stupid. Or the worst insult I've ever dished out. Wait, did I say this on a podcast? I said on the podcast, right, Distorted? Did I say it on the podcast with Toast? The pimple butt, yeah. Yeah, I did use pimple butt as an insult. Pimple butt, you know, it can hit. It has its moments.
Yeah, so basically this is some kind of cursed POV.
Okay, to be fair, this is my favorite content creator's POV when he watches trains go by.
Because democracy basically means government by the people, of the people, for the people. But the people are retarded.
So I need to be a dictator. That's a sick campaign. That's a sick campaign to become a dictator. Yeah, you know? 20% chance that works.
What's up? Can a low come up in your crib? Nigga don't hate me because I'm beautiful, nigga. Maybe you got rid of that old yee-ass haircut you got. You get some bitches
terrifying.
On your dick. Oh, better yet, maybe Tanisha called you.
They love this GTA meme.
She ever stop fucking with that brain surgeon, the lawyer she fucking with, nigga.
Oh, this is a great one.
McDonald's is always fucking up my order, bro. I asked for Sprite and they gave me clown juice.
I asked for Sprite. No, we did this one. How the web became unreadable.
How the web became unreadable.
Well, he was born next to a nuclear power plant, has an IQ of 2, and got hit in the head with several rocks as a child. But boy, can this guy play basketball. Look at that, deep from 3. He's not the smartest player in the NBA, as you can tell here. He goes to the bench, and he has no idea what the fuck is going on. But boy, oh boy, has he been a threat so far on the defensive end. Check out this clip. From the other side of the court, he comes over and sends that ball in the stands.
He can't even dunk. He's got two big arms to dunk.
monkey.
Kyle sent me the Facebook banner.
It's terrifying. It's a terrifying banner. That is a terrifying banner, Kyle. Kyle be like, that's my girlfriend, smiley face. I'm sure they were a handsome couple.
All right, look, y'all. Flat color, inward bevel, stroke border, outward bevel, stroke border, outer glow, stroke border, another stroke border, outer bevel, drop shadow, big fat wood stroke border, outward bevel, and another drop shadow. Wow, and we haven't even talked about the three other fonts yet.
That is kind of crazy. That is okay. You know what? I'll give it to him. I would have never thought of this. I would have just said, oh, this looks nice, but I would have never thought they go a little crazy there. I don't think I want to click this one. Let me go by all time. I can't hear it. Pog. Good video.
Number one, hey! We are number one, hey! Now listen closely. Here's a little lesson in trickery. This is going down in history.
Classic. Man, he was an icon of Reddit, huh?
Audio rolling. Action.
He was like a Reddit heartthrob. This is a classic.
President Obama will go down as perhaps the worst president in the history of the United States! Exclamation point. At real Donald Trump. Well, at real Donald Trump, at least I will go down as a president.
When you open your heart to patriotism, there is no room for prejudice.
Classic. Alex Ernst flies across the country for 25 seconds.
Hey, it's Ian, and today I'm showing you how to make your own Dude Perfect videos at home. So a lot of these shots look pretty impressive, but they're actually pretty easy to do. All you have to do is try it a bunch of times and only show the take where you actually make the shot. So after editing, the shot looks effortless, like so. Fucking God!
That's easy. Easy as that, man.
So he's calling you a terrible name. And you know that if you punch him out, it'll just confirm all the bad stuff he thinks about you.
Yes. You know what it feels like to be judged simply because of how you look?
Of course I do. I'm part robot.
He is. He is.
It's the Statue of Liberty.
Yeah.
I'm about to shit my pants.
Hello?
That was good. was this supposed to be? Why is everyone freaking out? What was this original? What was the original video? Don't worry about it. All right, cool. Hey, I'm not worried.
Wait, we forgot Gibby.
Oh yeah.
Oh yeah, right.
Gibby!
Did you guys hear my ribs crack?
Thank you very much.
That's unironically kind of what the vibe of Marvel movies is in a way. Without the laugh track, they are pretty much just like sitcom humor. Which, you know, have their moments. It's fun. Oh my God. All right, I'll do these few more. Okay, that looks like a giant pair of knockers, so I'm not going to do that.
Ask yourself, could this meeting be a Zoom? Could this Zoom be a phone call? Could this phone call be an email? Could this email be a text? Could this text be unsent? Could we in silence retreat to the forest? Could we, by game trails and forgotten paths, vanish into the trees?
This is insane! What do you think is gonna happen? That I'm gonna go enslave my friends for a bunch of aliens I've never met? And I don't care if I live a fucking million years. This is my home, and I won't let you destroy it.
Oh, okay. How about this? Because when I need a job done, I get someone with a job to do that job!
Good mashup. That's a good subreddit, dude. I miss doing Reddit reviews. Well, I need some new hotness, some new hot subreddits where they have some funny joke and whatnot. You're welcome. Thank you, Jiggle Jib, everybody. Hearts for Jiggle Jib in chat for a great suggestion of a great subreddit. What subreddit should we do next time, boys? Let me know. Perhaps I'll do it. Perhaps we'll figure it out. Yes. Or perhaps we could dive into the world of the Super Auto Pet subreddit. What? Wow. That's crazy. You just get an 8-8 can. Wow. Wow, you have to have a lot of draws to get there. That's crazy. Cats are crazy, huh? It would be crazier if they did Rebecca Black versus Rick Astley, though. That is true. Cats are crazy. Rebecca Black would be a little crazier. All right, chat, we're probably going to boot into the world of Super Auto Pets. But before we do that, I am going to, because we missed it last week, we're going to water our plants. Wait, don't sing that. It's literally a porn song. Okay, fair enough.
All right, let's water the plants.
Yeah? Update day.
What?
New Wii titles.
What? I'm in the bathroom.
Update day for the Wii shopping channel.
It's funny because normally they do it at midnight, but it's like 11. It's like 11:15. What time is it in Japan? Fucking turn that up. I love that grooving. What kind of music is that? Like a bossa nova beat?
Makes me really want to just croon it.
This is such a danceable song. You know what we should do? We should write a song for our act with titles of Wii games.
Oh, I like it.
Because everybody knows about the Wii Shopping Channel.
Yeah.
And everybody loves to shop on it every Wednesday. So what we'll do is we'll write a theme song for the Wii Shopping Channel. Watch this. You can sing to the titles of the Super Mario RPG, Super Mario 3, Mega Man, Neo Turf Masters, Breaking Star. You know what I mean, Jared?
Yeah.
Like every star, you say the lyrics of the.
Let me try one.
Let me try.
Super Mario RPG, Sonic the Hedgehog, Donkey Kong 3, Adventures of Lolo 1 and 2, King's Knight, Dig Dug, Juman Foo, Harvest Moon.
Did you write this song?
League Puzzle Pokemon, Toe Jam and Earl in Panic on Funkotron. Castlevania, Fatal Fury, Ninja Chachuma, Rook Comet, Razor Blazing, Lasers, Basis Loaded, Mega Turukon, Cybernator, Rolling Thunder, Dynastic Hero, Bubble Bobble, Double Triple, Double Dragon, F-Zero.
I get it, you memorized
F-Zero
the song.
F-Zero X, and Donkey Kong Jr. Math, Ninja Gaiden 1, Ninja Gaiden 2, Ninja Gaiden 3, Cruising USA.
Wow!
No!
Consequences to it, though.
No! I'm back. Give me something else to watch. I only need a few more seconds of cleaning this thing.
Donatello, Michelangelo, Leonardo, Raphael, versus Leonardo, Michelangelo, Donatello, and Raphael!
We got cowabunga dudes, so let's get it on. Reptiles against the fathers of the Renaissance. We got the classical technique to kick these three-toed freaks back onto the street. Ooh. I take the turtle and I turn him into mincemeat. You don't really want to step to Da Vinci. I love the ladies, I like to keep it mellow. So let me pass the mic to my man Donatello. Hard shell, but you're gross in the middle. Wouldn't want to touch you with a six-foot chisel. Born in goop, raised in poop. I slice through a group of ninjas like fruit. Ooh.
Yo, double yell when I came to flow. Being dope by the Pope and a bone till I crow. I'm an MC sweater, but I get the feeling. I should pass it up to my man.
Every birth of rap addicts, you beat the foot, but it won't go well.
When you catch an Italian boot to the half shell.
The wisdom of our master taught us not to rush to violence. But our master
ain't here, dude.
I don't think you wanna mess with my guitar to play.
Be back in your floppy helicopter fly away.
I can beat my up a steady rock a mic sucker. I'm a pristine, cysteine, nunchucker. Oh hi, I'm a cool but rude guy. Put you back in school with the tip of my two side.
Donna, tell me who you are again, dude. Cause I don't got him a lot of clue what you do.
That's because you mutants are too immature.
You wouldn't know genius if I'm pissing your soul.
We got the tell
and the mind and the rhyme so sweet.
We're like your NES game.
Cause we can't be beat.
Yo, go ahead and hate, we just skate on by.
You guys draw more dicks than New York Pride.
For the team, man, team,
jump, kick it out,
leave.
Chat with
us, chat with
me,
the pizza.
Yeah, slice
for me.
Nope, no more epic and a rap a battle of history. We'll do season one soon, chat. We'll do season one soon. The thing is, chat, I kind of need content this week, so I don't want to spoil it all today. Because this week, I'm going to be spending pretty much all of it with Cutie's family.
And so, I'm not going to be at my setup. So I just need shit to do during the day and stuff. You know what I mean? Like, I think I'll have a setup over there, but it will be kind of janky. So the easiest thing to do will probably be react and stuff. But I won't have as much. I won't have as much time on the main setup until I come back. But then next week, everything should go back to normal. Like, I don't know. I'm gone until like this weekend, and then Sunday it should be a normal stream. But then I think Monday I'm doing Mizzy. I think I can leak that. Is that leak? Yeah, Mizzy's game show. I think I can leak that. I hope that's not a leak. I think he announced it. I don't think it's a leak. There's no universe where I leak something before Mizkif. He said it earlier. Okay, cool. And then we have Mogul Money on, I think it's Wednesday, right? So starting like Thursday, everything will be normal. But the next like 10 days will be kind of weird because I'm going to Cutie's family and then all that shit. The holidays. You know the holidays get a bit weird.